Enter the mirror. Flesh! The sunrise gives the sea a blazing golden sheen, and all the city, from the far harbor shanties to the splendid square just below you, basks in its light. The breeze blows fresh and brisk off the water. The song of nightbirds gives way to the chatter of clerks and touts, and your black-veined hands, twisted like talons, tremble on the water-sill. Behind you, men bicker about tests and shins, about a rot that has reached the heart and brain and cannot be cut out. You turn away from the window and face the men, just as the closest of them, a one-armed servant in sumptuous garb, cries that there must be more that can be done, whatever the cost. But the other, a chirurgeon, snaps back. I am no mountebank like Chalipa, flinging ciphers at the sick till there are no more shins to shake loose. It is not healing to stir false hope in those doomed to die. They break off their debate to look your way. You don't recognize them at all, but plainly they know you and expect you to speak. Demand to know who they are. The servant's eyes widen, first with something like anger, and then with something like understanding. He steps closer to you, and, in an almost tender gesture, lifts a hand toward your face. His one hand, his one arm, his other armless side smoothly swaddled in silk. Armless side. I am Cardugo, your grace. You know me. And without it quite being so, he is right. Even poisoned as your body is, feels the flush of friendship. And this is Aram of the island. He has been treating your condition. The chirurgeon nods slightly, adding, My services are at an end, your grace. My grace. The roots have spread too far, too deep. What the wind sowed must now be reaped. So I'm royalty of some kind. My condition? Roots? The wind? The guy stopped pacing. Well, that stepping is annoying. The two men share a quick, obvious glance, and your frail body quivers at the gesture. Cardugo draws closer. The wind touched you, your grace. As he says it, his fingers dance as if unbitten upon the flat expanse of his maimed side. Ugh. The iron wind, what it touches, it changes, seldom for the better. Your changing was slow. All these years you fought it. The doctors fought it. We fought it together. The islander's voice has none of Cardogo's softness. And now you have lost. You are leaving this life at last. All that remains is to decide what you will do, or is to decide whether you will do so properly. What's wrong with your side, Cardugo? He shakes his head. You know, your grace. The wind changed me too, when I sought to shield you from its touch. I failed you then, as the doctors have failed you now. Perhaps he sees your eyes lingering upon his unbalanced body. We both paid too high a price, your servant says, his voice breaking slightly. I'm sorry. It wasn't you who made the wind, your grace. And it was I who begged you to go with you, begged to go with you to the border march. I went freely, and freely did what was right, and you've given me better things than an apology. Then, as if ashamed at this outburst, your servant glances at the doctor. I will try to bear the burden more lightly, your grace. You carry too heavy a load already. With a sharp smile, Aram answers, Your grace will not bear that burden much longer. Asked the doctor to examine Cardugo. No, the doctor says curtly, I am not here to treat your servant. If you wish to retain me to do so, you may call at my place of business. He looks at Cardugo. He knows where to find me. Turning back to you, he adds, As for you, the treatment is done. Aram gestures broadly at the ciphers, trophies, and treasures that adorn the walls. Your life was full, but the hourglass is empty. Now you must rest for a while. Then forever. The deep ache in your skull and spine, the ragged weakness of each breath, and all your body's other voices cry their confirmation of the doctor's words. This will not kill me. I will not die. Trembling, you swear you will defeat the rot, perhaps with the aid of this Jalipa, alone if you must. As your rant rages on, your voice grows more ragged, and at last you stagger back and catch hold of your desk to keep you from falling. The doctor shakes his head and leaves, and Cardogo helps you into a chair. You won't fight alone, Your Grace. He wipes sweat from your brow. For now, though, you must rest. I will have the kitchen prepare a broth, and I will let your family know. He lingers a moment longer without saying why. When he goes, a tremendous weariness overtakes you. Beyond the window, the sun has risen, and the sea is restored to old gray waves crashing on a sullied shore. The hours of rest have won you no strength, and the soup sits uneasily in your stomach. Cardogo dusts your face with rouge to hide its pallor, slides white gloves over your twisted hands, wraps you in a padded jacket that adds lost flesh and masks the bulbous growths. He tucks and folds and buttons and at last passes you a looking glass. In your trembling grasp it shows nothing more or less than rot and sickness. You look like a corpse prepared for funeral display. Cardogo has hidden nothing. He has merely framed your condition as a euphemism that others can bear. They are waiting, he says, and he guides your chair forward. Your eyes flick across the drawing room, alighting on the vast map covering the far wall, the shining oddment of crystal and azure steel whirling in a corner, the shelves of ancient tomes, the writhing fire caged in the hearth. Then there are the men and women, young and old, all gazing expectantly, scores of stares you cannot meet in a sea of unfamiliar faces. On some, fear and desperation are naked. Other guests have done better in their concealment. A neatly groomed man in a neatly fitted officer's uniform sobs messily. He is the exception. Is that this guy? Cardogo puts his hand on your shoulder, and a hush falls. Your Grace, the family is gathered. To you alone, he says. They await your words. Try to ease their fears. They know you are dying. Your family may be strangers to you now, but anyone could see their fear, namely, that they will fall with you, followers that they are. You must set them free. You speak of your weakness and their strength, of the darkness you face, and the bright days ahead for them. You say that a family is, by definition, more than one member. Too soon your well-worn words run out, and Cardogo ushers the crowd from the room. The officer, however, insists on staying, and your servant at last relents. Your Grace, your nephew Salvar, begs a word. He withdraws a discreet distance. Okay, so that's who this guy is, nephew Salvar. Salvar. Salvar has everything you've lost, strength, beauty, vigor, and yet his haunted eyes, condemned eyes, are all too familiar. He bows, and, thinking his face hidden, wipes it quickly with a handkerchief. As he rises, he kisses your gloved hand. Your Grace. His voice, for all its glorious tenor, quivers as if he is far weaker than he looks. You have given me so much, and now, as your end draws near, I hope at last to prove my worth. His harried eyes dart about as he gives his little speech. Is something troubling you? A false smile reveals brilliant teeth. No, not at all. I have discovered a wonderful opportunity, a mercantile venture in need of a leader, a man of precisely my skills, and a chance to purchase shares in the ongoing concern, preferred stock. He stutters slightly over the foreign vocabulary of business. I can make good on what you've given me. Prove that your faith in me was wisdom. The smile crumbles. I just need a stake to buy in. He means shins, of course. Tell me more about this venture. Salvar nods, too fast, too many times. It is not without danger, physical danger I mean, which is why they need a man who can swing a sword. He is interrupted by a cough from Cardogo. The venture? Ah, yes. Well, it involves certain saleable commodities that are in great demand in the Oasis of Emrajolios. Strictly highest workmanship, of course, but sold here like trinkets. So you see exactly the sort of thing a sharp trader corners in the market, as they say. Does it sound like he's being tricked, or does it sound criminal? Physical danger. For a man who could swing a sword. Saleable commodities. Things sold here like trinkets but are in great demand in the Oasis. I don't see any evidence of 3 and 4. Of course it could be true. Don't know. Number 1 doesn't seem a good choice because while I'm considering, I'll probably die. And I won't put it through, so I'll make sure you are provided for. Almost instantly, the fearful look leaves your nephew's eyes, and a beautiful serenity smooths his brow. Thank you. Thank you, he says softly. Then with a champion's tenor, he vows, I will make you proud! Cardogo leads him from the room. That's as close as I can get to a champion's tenor, guys. When your servant returns, he shakes his head. You have showered that boy in shins, your grace, and shared a greater wealth and wisdom. To no avail. A person can always be changed. Well, is, Cardogo, or whatever his name, right? Cardogo, yeah. Cardogo flinches at your words, and the scorn falls from his face. After a moment's humble silence, he eases your chair back towards your suite. It has been a long day, your grace. You should rest. A soporific and anodyne mist brought by Cardogo dulls the daggers that stab your nerves, and soon sweet oblivion settles over you. You awaken in a dark night, with the certainty that you are not alone. Your uneven heartbeat races, and your rot-riddled eyes strive to find an intruder. Who's there? You hiss. A shadow sits at the foot of the bed, illuminated by the false fire glow of a cipher around her wrist. As your eyes adjust, her face becomes faintly visible. You recognize her from the gathering. She was at the back of the drawing room, and she left before anyone else. Casca, she answers, identifying herself, though by now she knows you've seen her. Or have you forgotten me entirely? Is Casca... I know we've heard that name before. Casca. Is she the one that we found in the first merecast adventure? Not sure. Why are you here? To pay my last respects, Casca scoffs as she signs her cipher over your withered, trembling body. That is, if I had any. She gives a short, sharp laugh. No. What I want is what you've been giving my sweet, sweet, soft, rotten cousin Salvar all these years. Your shins. Why should I give you my money? In the twilight, she gives a short, flat reply. Because I've suffered. My shins will make you soft like Salvar. Better to go stronger by earning them yourself. Right. I should climb Sega's cliffs, hand over hand, until at last, bloody-fingered and bruised, I reach the top and proudly look over the wide ocean while the sunrise turns it all to gold. She says the last in a sneering imitation of your voice. That's it, right? That's how you earn it? She draws closer. Well, I've been climbing all my life, and I've got the bruises. She shines the cipher on her face, where a fresh, livid blotch spreads across her sharp features. And yet, there I am, still in the god's damned underbelly, low enough to smell the skist bobbing on the waves. It's her. She's the one who killed those people in the underbelly and made that symbol. The symbol that we then found in the Tomb of Dead Heroes, I think is the name. It's Casca. She killed all these people. When does this take place? After she killed them? Well, after she killed them, she fled from the underbelly. So this is either during or before. I'm thinking before. So Casca's uncle we are playing as. So don't tell me what makes me stronger. I don't want stronger. I am stronger. I want this, she says, ripping your blanket off you. I want my own bed in my own house and never have to share it. I want shins enough to drown my past, to murder my past. A whole armor of shins, the kind of armor that lets you be soft. She leans closer still. But no, you. Your money was for bold, beautiful Salvar. Alright, fine. When I'm gone, you'll be provided for. Casca nods once, without saying a word, and then darkens the cipher on her wrist. Without its light, the room becomes completely black, utterly silent and empty, but for the whisper of her departure and the ever-present pain within you. Weakness and throbbing pain are the morning's gifts, unblended by the herbal broth Cardogo has brought. Death will not stop knocking. By the time the clocks cry out midday, a palsy has seized your left hand. Your servant gives you a relic to grip, some ancient creature locked in amber. It slips from your grasp and shatters on the floor. The beast flies away. At that moment, a caller is announced. Cardogo leaves, then returns, visibly dismayed. The mendicant, Your Grace. Without awaiting an invitation, your visitor enters, a tall man, stiff and slender as a poker, finely dressed and bangled with ciphers. He glows with a confidence, I like that, as he gives a half bow. Your Grace. At a curt nod from the mendicant, Cardogo steps out. Your guest then sits beside you and takes your hand. I have heard, he says softly, naturally not from Cardogo, but your family cannot help but share their panic within the city. His eyes glisten with fathomless compassion, or at least a fine simulacrum of it. The hour against which you have prepared for so long has come round at last, and they, who surely knew the day would come, are as unready as house pets. They have leaned on you greatly, but then so have I, and so have our children. He gestures to the leather portmanteau he has set at his feet. I am here to bring your plans to completion. Our children? The mendicant eyes you carefully, then gently nods. I know that a cloud has fallen on your mind. It would give me great joy to lift it. For many years your generosity has given new hope to the dispossessed and neglected children of this city. A long lifetime's worth of wealth has transformed what my hospice can provide. The lands alone, your old hunting reserves, and the mouths they now feed. The wrecking field at Crefton, and the honest labor of gleaning its Numenera. The campus of the hospice itself, and all the lost souls it houses. As you insisted, no one knows of these gifts but us two and your solicitor. He smiles, and now I seek to drink the last dregs of your estate. No one knows? The mendicant nods. Naturally, they suspect. One cannot turn a pleasure garden into an orphanage without gossip. He shrugs. And it is hard to conceal anything from Cardogo. I fear that he doubts my sincerity. He pats the bag at his feet. In the end, of course, the truth will be known, and from high to low the city will admire your kindness. And it is on that kindness they wish once more to impose. Why do you need more? The mendicant shakes his head sadly. Our world knows no end of need, Your Grace. There are so many children who have been betrayed and cast aside. With a great weary sigh, he says, There is one in particular whom I wish to show you, if I may. He unhinges the portmanteau's clasp and begins to reach in. As if in response, the shaking in your hand grows stronger. Of course. From his bag, the mendicant takes a glass tube filled with a swarm of ants. Next comes rich parchment, which he lays upon your desk. With a deft motion, he pulls the cap from the tube and pours the ants on the page. They skitter madly, but not aimlessly, oozing acids on the page until they've etched a flawless picture. You see a young girl afflicted with almost unspeakable corruption, half her flesh a wilderness of misplaced parts and oozing sores. One of Cardogo's brood, the mendicant mutters. Most of them are killed at birth, by the whores, if not by him. Unbidden, a strangled sound escapes you, and Cardogo bursts in. The mendicant slips out without another word.
Huh.
The mendicant told me about your children. Cardogo's face turns red with rage, and then, as he shares the formidiograph of his daughter, shame.
I see, he whispers, turning away.
Face hidden, voice low, he confesses. I was a man when Kaylee let me join you in the border march, and a monster when we wed. Her love never flinched. He begins to pace. Could mine? She wanted a child, but I dared not burden her with another such as me. As he steps forward, black motes swirl in a space between you. Jalipa swore there was still some good in me, untouched by the wind that could grow in my wife. He reaches out. But I had to know, for her sake. Before you can condemn or absolve, the fit comes, and all else goes. The darkness fades, in part. The agony stays, redoubled. Through a haze you see your bedroom, and the two men beside your bed. Cardogo is one. His hand is on your bony shoulder. His companion, proper and every punctilio, is another stranger. Your Grace. You barely hear Cardogo's voice. It is as if your ears are packed with wadding. I have brought your solicitor. The man sniffs. As you recall, Your Grace, you declined my offer to draft a will against this day. He speaks of mortgages and credit lines and accounts payable, wasting your last life on a lawyer's long-winded way of saying what little wealth you truly have left. Now you must tell me, how am I to dispose of the residuum? Let's see all the choices. So many choices. Divide it as you promised. Salvor funded. Find Casca. Establish a trust for Cardogo's children. Bestow it upon the mendicant's hospice. Divide it evenly among my family. I'm not dead yet. I'm afraid if I choose 7, I'll be choosing nothing, and I'll just die. Now, Salvor and Casca are considered my family, right? So if I divide it evenly among my family, she'll get some? I'm assuming? Unfortunately, I don't think Cardogo is considered my family. And the hell with the mendicant. I don't trust him. Not sure I could trust Salvor either. And Casca's a murderer. Oh, is she making sacrifices for fortune or something like that? Because he didn't give her any of the money? She needs all that money to get out of the underbelly, and then she's killing people and making symbols that I guess are portals. If they match the other symbols, they're portals into the Valley of Dead Heroes. Divide it evenly among my family. You can barely whisper the words. Divide it evenly among my family. But as the final darkness creeps across your vision, you see the solicitor nod. Your life's last short span stretches almost infinitely, and in it you see all the unfamiliar, fearful faces that crowded your drawing room, and you see all those fears eased, in part, by your bequest. Then the image fades, and the darkness turns to golden waves lapping on the shore, and your long days are finally done. I don't know why I care about helping Casca so much. She kills people. But maybe this stops her from killing people? I have no idea.
I'm ready to learn something new.
Who's the singer and who's the song? Who writes these lyrics? They are... Dominant tides have shifted.
Yes.
Looks like my skills have increased. All I can do is effort. Tier 3, I get ambush. Gain an additional plus 15% on attacks and convert all damage to relativistic. Whatever that means. We should be able to mouse over these things. I know what they mean. When attacking while hidden or targeting an enemy that is blinded. None can prepare themselves for your vicious ambush. You leap from the shadows to deliver a devastating surprise attack. And cipher limit increase, which is always good. Plus one. Oh my, so many choices. Ability is resourceful. Plus one training and cipher use skill for additional ciphers. I just got that. I'm good with that. Datasphere link, plus one on all these. Lore machinery, mystical and natural. Entropic field. You know, I thought we had that already. I guess it's Kellerstees who has that. I thought I used entropic field. No, you know, I didn't think I used it last time. You create an energy siphoning vortex, weakening all within its radius. None can stand before you. So it's minus 2 armor and minus 1 resistance. Armor reduction minus 2 per tier. Resistance reduction minus 1 per tier. Active for 3 rounds. Good debuff, it seems. Incite action. Target an ally with enemies in weapon range to choose one of those enemies. The chosen ally makes an immediate attack on that enemy. Oh. You focus on an ally, sharpening their reflexes and boosting their reaction times with your formidable psychic strength. So it takes 3 intellect. I guess it looks like it turns intellect to me into speed for them. Insight action. Oh, that's what I just looked at. Quantum step. Alright, the teleport one. I think Callistius has that. I haven't used it yet. Targeting eye. Plus 15% on esoteric attacks. A mechanical enhancement to your biological eye helps you focus your more esoteric attacks. That's neat, because I use that a lot. Unstoppable force. Plus 2 damage on esoteric attacks. Your unrivaled mental prowess strengthens your esoteries beyond the capabilities of weaker beings. Plus 1 damage. Plus 15%. Now you know what's neat about this? This is a percent. So, your base attack increases for your esoteric, you gain plus 15%. So, it looks like this might level up as your, you know, not as you level up, but whatever damage you're doing with whatever spell you're using, plus 15% on top of that. This, however, is plus 2 damage, just a flat plus 2 damage, and it doesn't matter if you're casting the most unbelievable spell that's 100 damage, you know, of mental, transdimensional, whatever, it's then just 102. So, I think the targeting eye would be the better of the two to choose. So far I'm going for that anyway, out of one of two. Gravity manipulation we looked at last time with Callistius. I think I had her pick that, actually. Mind barrier. Gain plus 1 intellect, cool and +1 armor. Your mind is an impenetrable tower of iron will, a fortress few can breach. That's good too. Energize? Energize me. 2 intellect. Choose a damage type. Confer energized. All damage dealt is converted to the chosen type. Turn the mysterious forces of the world to your advantage. Fill your friends with power and your enemies with regret. Bring the family. Act of 3 rounds. Okay. That seems like it could be interesting. I'm assuming at some point we'll come across things that are vulnerable. I mean, maybe they are already, but just more obviously vulnerable to certain attacks. And, you know, immune to others. Scanning array. Gain a +5 bonus for each level of effort applied to perception, lore machinery, lore mystical, and lore natural tasks. You create a temporary matrix in your corneas that highlight and sharpen details that might have otherwise remained hidden. Hmm. What's the other thing I wanted? Mind barrier? I mean, +1 intellect, sure, but it's the armor that I need. So I'm going to take mind barrier and targeting eye. Boop. Is that a thought? A stray note? Just a pebble. Well, that was interesting. The merecaster is quiet and unresponsive. It seems there's no way to access it again. Time is tolerable in increments of a single millimeter, but no longer. That seems pretty bad for you, because you're spending a lot of time down here. So next time, guys, I think we'll head for we'll head for some random ones and see what we uncover, and then eventually we're going to head towards the gate. And after that, the first caster's tomb, whereas supposing we'll find the other cast-offs. The first cast-off's tomb. Where did I put that memory? It smelled like cheese! Oh no, it's Sheogorath! Okay, thanks for watching, guys. See you in the next episode. And endure. In enduring, grow strong.